In North Carolina, alienation of affection is basically when a third party interjects themselves into your marriage and causes the affections of your spouse to be taken away. And a lot of people mistakenly think that, okay, this is just a paramour type of situation. This is somebody that comes in and steals the affections of your wife, and she's got a new boyfriend now, and that can only happen that way. And that's not the case. In North Carolina, we've actually had mother-in-law suits where the mother-in-law has gotten in the way, or the father-in-law has gotten in the way of the marriage and just took a happy marriage and made it an unhappy one because the affections of the wife is no longer with the husband, or the affections of the husband is no longer with the wife because this third party's interjected themselves into the marriage and made it that way. We're one of a handful of states that still has this on the books. In order to prove an alienation of affection case, you have to prove that, number one, there was a happy marriage. And we all know, especially guys that have been married longer than 10 years, obviously every day is not a full, blissful, joyous day of being married. And that's not really what this is, that's not really what the standard is. The standard is, all in all, was this a normal marriage? Was it a marriage that was, a joyous marriage? Something that, you considered to be a good relationship, before this third party interjected themselves and caused the strain on the relationship. And that's what we're looking for. A lot of times you're going to find the proof that you're going to find for your alienation of affection cases to be successful is you may have a private investigator, because the spouse may get suspicious of the way the spouse is acting or her spouse is acting. Say, okay, something's not right here. I think my wife's cheating on me, or I think my husband's cheating on me. And a private investigator is brought into the picture, and there may be photographs, there may be video of the two going to a hotel or kissing or holding hands. A lot of times what you'll find, you can subpoena phone records and you'll see that there's like 16 hours of talk time between, this month and the end of this month, and, just a lot of texts back and forth, a lot of phone calls that normally just doesn't occur between two people that aren't in a dating type of relationship. So if you use the phone calls, social media is another way that a lot of people get into trouble. A lot of times when I take on one of these cases, if I'm suing the alleged paramour, I'm going to ask them as part of my discovery, download your entire Facebook profile on this and give it to me. And a judge will order that. So I can see any of the messages they've shared, the likes, I can see the kinds of instant messages, what they're talking about with the other person. All these things lend a good amount of credibility for going forward, especially in front of a jury, because most of these cases are tried in front of juries, if they're tried at all. I would say the majority of the alienation of affections cases that I've worked on, I have taken these cases to trial before, but the majority of the cases I get do settle out outside of court, usually in a mediation type of environment, and there's generally some money that exchanges hands and a non-disclosure agreement signed. The damages available in an alienation of affection case are very wide-ranging. I think just recently out of Charlotte, we had a large verdict come down, also in Raleigh. And when I say large verdicts, I mean in excess of $1 million. We've had $4 million verdicts. We've had $9 million verdicts. There's even a movie of a case that had a large verdict that came down, I think, in the 80s or the 90s. They made a TV movie out of it for like one of these cable channels. But it's about North Carolina's alienation of affection. One of the most famous cases, I guess for a lack of better term, that we've handled at this firm was a case called Malachek v. Williams that went to the North Carolina Court of Appeals. And in that case, we kept the tort of alienation of affection constitutional in North Carolina. It was challenged as being unconstitutional. We took it all the way up to the Court of Appeals, where the three judges agreed all together, 3-0, that our side was correct in saying it was constitutional. Just because you don't like the tort doesn't mean it's not constitutional. And that was upheld for the benefit of the client. Actually, that case made international news. We were featured not only locally and on television by the local news channels here, but it was also carried over in the UK by the Daily Mail, who ran a large article on it. So we received a lot of attention for that case. Alienation of affection cases aren't very, very common. I think there's only maybe 500 or so filed per year. A lot of times the cases are used as leverage by family law attorneys, leverage to get other things in order to drop the lawsuit. They may leverage it for child custody. They may leverage it for an unequal distribution of marital assets at the end of a, you know, during a divorce proceeding. So it just depends. A lot of times these cases are filed and they don't go to trial because, like I said, the majority of the cases I've handled like that, they settle outside of court. But I will say that it's something that I've had a lot of experience with versus maybe some other family lawyers that just don't see it as much. We probably get anywhere from 5 to 6 cases a month of people either thinking they have a claim for it or people that are trying to defend someone else's claim. Another tort that's usually attached to alienation of affection is a tort called criminal conversation. And all that really is a tort for adultery. So it's just the act of having sex itself. That's all that is. If you can prove that's what happened, then you know that's the tort that you go after. Criminal conversation a lot of times is easier to prove because you can use things like, oh, okay, they stayed at this hotel, both the vehicles were there all night, or you know, I saw her car parked in his driveway overnight. So you can kind of, a jury can kind of use that to say, okay, well, we know what's going on in there. Well, the reason that a lot of people pick me to be their alienation of affection attorney is, number one, the experience I've had in handling the cases, but also, number two, I'm a trial lawyer, first and foremost. I try criminal cases, I try family cases, and so they know that if they go with our firm that they're going to get that kind of dedication, that kind of fury that's associated with being a trial lawyer, knowing that we're going to go after whoever we need to go after with everything we've got. So one way or the other, either we're going to settle this matter outside of court at a number that everyone's happy with, or we're going to take it to a jury and the jury's going to decide what that number is going to be. Depending on the type of alienation of affection case, we have several different kinds. If the case is involving someone that's fairly, the defendant in the case is, if a prospective plaintiff comes to me and the defendant in the case has a lot of money or a lot of assets, sometimes we'll take those cases on a contingency fee basis. So we don't really need any money up front other than filing fees and things like that. Other times, if we're defending a case, someone that's accused of being the paramour, a lot of times that will be something that we would charge on an hourly basis, like we would with our family law representation, and you know, we do have payment arrangements for those types of matters. I handle all the alienation of affection cases that come into the office personally. The cases that I get on alienation of affection are sometimes in conjunction with a divorce. Sometimes they're outside of that. Maybe the person's already been through a divorce and have just come to me for the alienation of affection case. And sometimes, like I said before, they're used as leverage for a divorce case. It just depends. Every situation's different.